Today we're very excited to present Heather Rose, who joins us, who is an award-winning novelist based in Tasmania. Heather began her professional life in advertising and established a number of successful businesses and an international arts festival. And then drawing on her personal experiences of participating in spiritual life, Native American spiritual life, I should specify, she wrote her first novel, White Heart, I believe it was called. She's subsequently written several novels, and I believe has two due for release next year. Several novels including The Butterfly Man and The River Wife. And she's being joined today by Sue Saxon, our very own Sue Saxon, Education and Public Program Manager for Kaldor Public Art Projects, who herself has over 20 years experience in the arts as a practicing artist and in education. And today I believe they're going to focus on the idea of ritual practice and shamanism as it relates to Marina Abramović's work and the experiences that you've no doubt had in the project space here today. Heather Rose herself sat with Marina Abramović on four occasions at the Museum of Modern Art. You can see some of the images behind us. As Marina sat in silent gaze with members of the public over 736 hours, with, I believe, over 1,500 people. Some of you may have had that experience in the project space with a complete stranger, and you may feel free to talk about those experiences at the end of today's talk. But I now give you over to Sue and Heather. Thank you.
Thank you everyone for joining us today. It's the last day, as Antonia mentioned, and first and last things always have a special power, and we're going to refer a little to that power today in our talk with Heather. It being the last day, and some of you here, I believe, have been through the exhibition or through the experience, and we hope that you'll take the invitation to share your reflections on that experience during the talk today. But it's a moment where we can look back and see how these different exercises that Marina has designed have impacted on us. And there's no better person, I think, to share her reflections today than Heather Rose, because she herself sat with Marina four times, as Antonia mentioned, in 2010 at the Museum of Modern Art. And through that experience, came to write a novel which is almost to be published, on the threshold of being published. And in that novel, through her mediated experience, she has one of her characters, or several characters, sitting with Marina and discussing the impact of that and how it actually transforms and changes their own lives. So Heather herself has also spent some time, as Antonia mentioned, experiencing some ritualized practices and retreats, and she's going to relate some of those experiences to ideas about shamanism and Marina's particular command of these exercises. So in the first instance, Heather, welcome.
Thank you, Sue.
And what led you really to spend time, so much time in New York, sitting with Marina? What attracted you in the very first place?
I was at the National Gallery of Victoria back in 2005, and I'd been to see another show, you know, Monet's Lilies or something like that, and I wandered off into another room and saw a photograph on the wall, and it was a photograph of Rhythm Zero, the piece which Marina did in Naples in 1975, where she put 72 items on a table, and they included a rose and a bottle of olive oil, a knife, a chain, also a gun and a bullet, and invited the public to do whatever they wanted to her between the hours of 8 p.m. and midnight. And during the process of that, she was stripped, she was cut, the gun was loaded and put to her head, and someone tried to make her pull the trigger. The description of the photograph was on the side, as it usually is in art galleries, and it described that experience. And then it talked about the Great Walk, where she had walked the Great Wall of China to meet with Ule, her partner at that time, to say goodbye to each other. And I read those words about a woman who would, you know, make herself available to the public with 72 items of that could have created great kindness or could have created great violence, and then also had such a romantic heart that she would take a walk on the Great Wall of China to say goodbye to the person that she loved. And I instantly thought, that is a great character. I would love to write a book about that person. And for the first 5 years, I really created a novel that was drawn from her practices but was a totally imaginary central character with her own particular performance art practice. And in those days, it was actually quite hard to find information about Marina. I live in Hobart, and there really wasn't any information that I could get hold of in libraries. And online, often the information was in Italian or it was in Dutch, and there was a little bit of stuff, but it was quite difficult to find. And as I kept working, someone suggested to me that the new gallery in Hobart, Mona, which was in those days out the back of a shed in a suburb outside Hobart, that they had a fantastic library, but it was all in boxes, and maybe I should go and talk to the librarian. And so I did. I went out and was introduced to the librarian and started to tell her that I wanted to write a novel about a performance artist. And she said, oh, you mean like Marina Abramović? And it was the first time I'd ever heard anyone else say her name. And so I literally worked in a little tiny storeroom at the old Mona, at the back of a warehouse, where I would be getting the books out of the boxes. And David Walsh has had the biggest collection of probably Marina Abramović material of anyone in Australia, plus films and many. He has had a great interest in Marina all this time. So then when Mona opened, they gave me a studio to write in, and so I spent a couple of years out there writing the novel. And then, of course, and that was a little later, because in 2010 someone said to me, hey, do you know that Marina Abramović is doing a retrospective in New York and you should go? And so that's what led me to New York. And it was only really when I sat with Marina that I thought, I cannot fictionalise this woman. She's more colourful and brilliant and interesting than any character I could ever create. And so I approached her to ask her for permission to use her as the character in the novel, and she is the character. She is herself in the novel, although with a completely imagined presence. I don't know what goes on in Marina's mind, and in fact I've only met her very briefly once, which was about 3 weeks ago, so I had to imagine everything that would be going on in Marina's mind during The Artist is Present, and everything that's brought her to that time in her life.
Did anyone else in the audience sit with Marina at MoMA, just out of interest? The faces you see on the slides, these ones and the ones to come, are all captured by the photographer, Marco, of the people who sat with Marina. So, Heather, how did it come to be? What was the actual process that you went through in order to sit, not just once, but four times with Marina?
The first day, I got off the plane about midday or something from Australia, and as we all know, it's a very long way to go, especially from Tasmania. And I literally dropped my bags at the hotel and went straight to MoMA and rocked up, and there were, you know, it was the Atrium, and raced up the stairs, and there's all these people, and there's Marina in a red dress. It was April then, so she was wearing the red dress. And I walked around the back of the square, and I saw people were coming and going a bit, and so I thought, oh, good, I can just, you know, step in next or something. And then I realised there was this enormous queue sitting all the way around the square. And I thought, oh, okay, I've got to get here early tomorrow. And so the process was to go early. And then we would... it was so exciting, though, because for those of you who know MoMA, it's got a sculpture garden out the back, and there's a sort of an area after you've swiped your card through where people sit, and there's benches, and, you know, it's just a waiting area, and then you go upstairs to the Atrium. So it's quite crowded down there, and you have to wait, and people are waiting, and the guards are have a thing across the stairs, and it's all very precise, and they're signalling each other because they're getting used to the idea that this is becoming a very popular performance. And at sort of 10:29, the the guard at the top of the stairs nods to the guard at the bottom of the stairs, and he slowly withdraws the sort of barrier. And then people ran, and I just laughed. I remember standing there just laughing at these people, thinking, they're running for art. And they just ran like a huge, like worse than a football crowd, up the stairs, and then they all just raced around the edges of the atrium where the square was marked off, and did everything they could to sort of force themselves into line, because of course there was no restriction on how long anyone could sit. So the very first person could sit all day and would all go away again and wait for the next day. And because I was there in April, sometimes we only waited 4 or 5 or 6 hours, but other times as it got later, people were sleeping overnight in the street. They'd literally come out of MoMA, not having got to sit with Marina, and they would just walk round the front door again, get their sleeping bag out and stay all night and queue again.
If anyone's seen the film The Artist Is Present, which was on the ABC a couple of Sundays ago before the project opened, you get a real sense of the retrospective in which the actual... the gazing that Marina was involved in took place, because it was also set in the context of her previous works. And before I ask Heather to read from an excerpt from the novel that's based on that experience, I just wanted to point out to you as well that the exercises in this that people... Has everyone been through the show here? Has everyone been through the project? Anyone... Put your hand up if you've been through the project. And we also here have some repeat visitors. So those exercises that you've experienced have come from Marina's ritualised collection of practices called cleaning the house. And they emerge from her spending significant periods, including a year in the central desert with our own Indigenous Aboriginal people, and with Tibetan mystics as well. So a range of different communities where she's observed and really taken part in long periods of time in this kind of ritualised practice. And she had gathered those sort of practices and re-presented them to young performance artists who were learning to re-perform her work in the MoMA show in 2010, and then as a basis for the Marina Abramović method. So what you've experienced is an excerpt of the Marina Abramović method, which she believes is a fantastic process to then begin a creative act or to focus your own thoughts or practices. So for Heather, the initial sitting with Marina was already a trigger for her own creative work, and she's going to read us an excerpt from the book The Atrium, which is a working title at the moment. And we'll just go back to that image of the atrium that Heather's used as the inspiration.
So as you can see in the photograph here, I'm sorry it's not a very good photograph, it was just off my phone, but you can see the stairs at the top right-hand corner. So the atrium is open to all 5 floors of MoMA. And so you can look down at any point in MoMA and you would look down and see Marina, this little coloured dot when she was wearing the red dress, white when she was in the white dress, blue when she was in the blue dress, and because she did those for each month. And so there was never... at any time at MoMA, you were always conscious of this performance going on right in the centre of the gallery. And you can see the light set up here. And apart from Marina being herself in the novel, the other character that is himself, with permission, and again I've fictionalised him, but he has his own name, is Marco Anelli. And Marco Anelli is responsible for all the photographs that were taken during The Artist Is Present. He's a wonderful photographer and a beautiful man, and was gracious enough to let me do this to him. So this is an extract. It's day 47, and my beloved publisher, Jane Paul Freeman, is here, and Alan and Unwin are publishing this novel next year. So this is a little glimpse of the novel works by telling us a little bit about different people who come to the performance and either sit with Marina or don't, their observations. And this is a little bit about how Marco viewed his life during those 75 days. At night, after he has reviewed the photographs from the day and sent his recommendations to Marina, Marco has time to sleep. He can live on 6 hours a night, but there is no time for friends. Last night he dreamed of a party where he went from room to room looking for someone in particular, but never found them, and everyone was dressed as strange blue birds. The people in the queue asked him, "Will it be long?" He smiled. "It is impossible to tell." The same answer he gave everyone. When he and Marina had discussed this show, they had imagined the chair opposite Marina would often be empty. They had never imagined people would be drawn to sit, that they would queue for hours and hours. He tried not to engage in conversation in the atrium. He was not a spokesperson, he was the photographer. He checked his watch, a gift from Marina. How perfect that she should have given him time. It was a thing they shared. While ever she was here, he was also here. For 75 days, he was her constant witness. They had met in Rome when he had asked to photograph her, and she had offered him 10 minutes the next day. It was all the time she could give him, she said. She greeted him at the appointed time, and he had surprised her. It was not her face he wanted, it was her scars. The scars told her real stories, the scars that came from knives and ice, fire and scalpel, years of work on the tightrope between art and spirit, years of trying to create a philosophical bridge between East and West, a woman who wanted to explore what it was to be human, a part of history, a gateway. He did not pretend to understand her, so he admired her. He looked at her through the lens of his camera and saw in her dark eyes generations of Slavs and Arabs, Greeks and Persians who had ventured into that crumpled landscape at the crossroads of Europe and the Middle East. He imagined it wasn't easy for your country to change names, for the borders of your country to alter and people who were once your neighbours to become your enemy, people who would pick up an axe and kill you and your children, and you would do the same with whatever weapon you could find. That was Yugoslavia, a no longer country, a fairy story land of monsters, musicians, madmen and lovers on a stretch of peninsula between Austria and Macedonia. Bordered by Hungary, by Bulgaria and Romania, the once Yugoslavia had been squeezing and twisting and folding itself for so long that the whole peninsula was a steep-sided maze of valleys, rivers, lakes, villages, snow-capped mountains, an origami landscape with endless secrets. After the first 10 minutes of the photographic shoot, Marina Abramović had given Marco her whole day. She had said, over wine later, when the day was done and they were on the balcony of the hotel room, that if you dipped your fingers in the pockets of Yugoslavia, you could pull out stories of warm bread, onions and mincemeat, vine leaves and plum brandy, cornbread and strudel, old myths of the sun drawn from a palace by white horses, a young god dropping corn in spring, summer as a woman newly in love but abandoned each autumn. You could cut yourself on ancient mountain ranges and skin your knees on lost valleys, yet there were fields of red poppies and homemade wine, and someone singing ballads of virgins wandering in the moonlight, and old women who carried the bones of animals to stave off disease. There were other myths Marina had told him of large black cats that barked like dogs to protect the cows in the barn through the deep white winter. Spirits in the bathhouse, by the front door, by the fireplace. Rat catchers and shepherds, soldiers and priests, the world swathed in black, green, gold, red, magenta. When she planned this show, he said, "I will photograph everyone who comes to sit with you." 75 days, she said. "Are you sure? Can you do it?" It's a long time. They conversed always in Italian. He did English badly. Her Italian rumbled with Balkan vowels. His Serbian was hello, goodbye, thank you, tomorrow, hungry, one, two, three, beautiful. She spoke French and German too, and Dutch, and in every language she was funny, intense. I will stay with you for the entire show, he said, every day, so that no one is missed. Every face. We will capture every face. And so here he was in the middle of his promise, and spring was gracing the city outside. The children in the strollers who came into the atrium were no longer swathed and booted. They had bare legs. He smelled rain upon trench coats and wind in the wraps and scarves. For 75 days, he was an archivist. Every day, he took the clipboard and moved along the queue of people and had them sign a permission form to be photographed, their images to be used by Marina in any future works, books, films, performances. Nearly everyone signed. Then he returned to his camera and photographed face after face. He captured the moment when they first sat and their eyes connected with Marina. Then he photographed them when their emotions began to surface. A sitting could last 2 minutes or 2 hours or an entire day. They hadn't expected people to do that. So many expressions crossed the faces of those who sat. He looked for intensity. He looked for the moment when the person sitting was consumed by the indecipherable. He felt as if he was inside a world of raw truth. Who would have imagined there would be such faces? He had photographed architecture, history, musicians. Now he looked into the human face day after day, painted with curiosity, and he saw the abyss of history within the human heart. Everyone was its own beaten, salvaged, polished, engraved, carved, luminous form. He captured this ephemeral thing, a communion between an artist and her audience. Here in New York, where time was everyone's currency, and to gaze deeply into the face of another was possibly a sign of madness, people were flocking to sit with Marina Abramović. Here at MoMA, where people gave a Picasso a fleeting glance, a Monet, even a Pollock, just a moment or two of their invaluable time. Visitors were watching the performance for hours. She wasn't so much stealing hearts, he thought, as awakening them. The light that came into their eyes, their intelligence, their sadness, all of it tumbled out as people sat. Marco, with his long lens and archivist's eye, captured them all.
Thank you, Heather. So I think the book will be coming out next year. Yes, that's the plan.
So how would you define ritual?
My experience of ritual comes from both a Buddhist experience and also from Native American experience. And so my sense of ritual from those experiences is that certain practices are imbued with significance. And there is an element of repetition, and also the critical aspect is discipline. Discipline and focus, those two things. And it's been very interesting for me over the years researching Marina's work to see that not only does she come from a family where ritual and discipline were very apparent in her Orthodox Christian background, but that even as a small child, she was instructed in discipline and ritual through the way that her mother wanted the house to be kept, for example. Also, her grandmother went to church every day. There was a ritual of lighting candles before dinner. Marina had a lot of pattern and ritual in her life from a very early age. And watching her work evolve. I've been very interested to see how she's explored through many, many, many different avenues. You know, reading the early work of the Theosophical Society founders, the work she did with the Aboriginal people in Australia, South America and the crystals, Vietnam and looking at Buddhism and the Eastern principles. You know, it just goes on and on and on. And so when I looked at that, the artist is present, that performance is full of the things that you've all mentioned, trust, and also discipline, obviously the self-discipline to sit for 75 days is awesome in the true meaning of the word. Also with ritual, of course, there's often an element of pain, and in Native American ritual and many other rituals of Indigenous cultures, there's an element of pain which transgresses you and helps to take you outside yourself. And even doing the walking meditation in there, if you do it long enough, you'll start to get a little bit uncomfortable. Same as if you sit in the chair long enough, you'll start to feel a little bit uncomfortable. And using pain as a way of releasing yourself from the constraints of your intellect and moving into whatever is beyond that.
So could you talk about experiences that you've had, particularly your interest in sun dancing, which is a very specific type of ritual. And tell us a bit about its background too.
Sun dancing is I've never ever talked about this in public, so excuse me for being a little bit awkward about it. I wrote my first novel called White Heart is about this experience, but I've never talked about it.
Sundancing world debut.
My world debut.
Welcome,
that's
to
right.
The world debut.
So sundancing is one of the rituals of the Plains Indians in America, in North America. It's also practiced by other tribes. The Diné and various other tribes do a sundancing ritual. But the sundancing ritual is one of the rituals for life. Other rituals include, you know, the making of relatives, the throwing of the ball, which is a ritual game, sweat lodges that some of you might have heard about, vision quests that some of you might have heard about. Sundancing is the ceremony that is for the health of the people. And so the practice is that you arrive, you do 4 days of preparation, and those 4 days include sweat lodges three times a day. And then if you're admitted to the ceremony as a dancer, and you have to be admitted, you have to, a medicine man basically checks you out pretty seriously, in the way that medicine men do. And I had been on a vision quest before I did this. I'll start at the beginning. I was living in Melbourne. I went to a sweat lodge workshop outside Melbourne. I got very called to whatever that was. I had not expected that to be part of my life in any way.
Can you just explain what a sweat lodge is?
A sweat lodge is it's like an igloo that we make out of blankets and pine willow boughs. So we make a sort of igloo with a small door. And there's a pit in the middle of the sweat lodge that is used to hold red hot stones. And we have a fire here, and we make a big fire, we heat the stones on the fire, and then we carry them into the sweat lodge. We all get into the sweat lodge, we close the door, and you stay in there for anything from 2 hours to a whole night, depending on what the ceremony is. And the door is opened ritually, you know, four times through that process, and there is a firekeeper who looks after the fire outside and takes care of bringing in more stones. So it's a purification ceremony. As you can imagine, it gets incredibly hot. So it's a purification ceremony, and it really does transport people right outside their comfort zone. So I did a weekend workshop on that, and then I got very drawn to doing more of whatever that was. Where did that come from? So a friend of mine put me in contact with a man in San Francisco, and I took a great leap of faith and flew to San Francisco, hooked up with a lovely guy called Daniel and his girlfriend, and then I got, and he told me, look, there's a vision quest that if you want to be part of Sundancing, you will have to go and do this vision quest, and after the vision quest, they will or will not then you'll travel up to meet this Indian medicine man, and he will assess whether you are a person that would be allowed into a Sundance. And it's an incredibly private ritual. Not very many Western people have done it. I don't know any other Australians that have done it. I hope there are some. And so I went through the vision quest. I did 4 days and 4 nights out in the wilds of New Mexico on my own with a blanket. And then I drove to Oregon to, the Chips family had their Sundance that year in Oregon. And I did 4 days of preparation, and Charles Chips, who was the Sundance chief, said, yep, they used to call me Kangaroo Woman, which was pretty funny. And just as a nickname, not as anything serious, please don't think that's my spirit name. And and then we start dancing. And so the very first morning of the night before, all the women go into their own lodge and the men go into their lodge, which are teepees. And in the morning when the sun comes up, which at that time of the year, because it's high summer, is, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning, we get up and we dance from sunrise to sunset, which is 9 o'clock at night. And we have 3 sweat lodges through the day, and for 4 days we don't eat and we don't drink, and we're in incredibly hot sweat lodges, you know, morning, noon and night. And it is one of the most extraordinary things anybody could ever live through.
It sounds like a feat of endurance as well as anything that then takes you to a different sort of state.
Mm. And you have to commit to do 4 years. So I flew out every year for 4 years and spent 3 months in America. 2 of those trips, my son Alex, who was age 3 and then age 5, came with me on the second and the fourth trip. And we camped and hung out with the people that we met. And the thing is, of course, with ritual, is that it doesn't end at the end of 4 days. You have 4 days to recover. But of course, it actually takes a whole year to recover, and it takes a whole year to prepare. So really, I look at that time as a 4-year period where every single day I was sundancing in some form.
So this was a specific ritual. Was there a leader who took you through that? Because we were also referring to this idea of the shaman.
Well, you know, Sundance chiefs are very interesting people. They are generally, they come from Sundance chief families. Like Yuwipi men come from Yuwipi families. So the Chips family were very gracious to me, and I danced with them that year, and then they said, can you come home to us in South Dakota next year and dance with us in South Dakota? So I went to their family Sundance in South Dakota the next year, and the third year one of their family wanted to do a dance in New Mexico, so I went with them and the family of dancers that I'd begun to be very connected with, and I danced with them in New Mexico, and I danced with the same people in New Mexico in the fourth year too.
So looking at this description or definition of a shaman, a person who acts as intermediary between the natural and supernatural worlds, using magic to cure illness, foretell the future, or control spiritual forces. The idea of a shaman comes originally from the Siberian Tungus people, and it comes from the Tungus verb to know. So using noting similarities and cultural diffusion, scholars expanded the term shaman to indicate similar practitioners in other cultures. And in our conversation today, we're referring to the word shaman as meaning a person who acts as this intermediary and who perhaps heals within the spiritual dimension by returning lost parts of the human soul from wherever they've gone. The shaman also cleanses excess negative energies which confuse or pollute the soul. So I think in a way we're drawing a bow here between the practices that you have the opportunity to experience and re-experience today, I hope, and this idea of cleansing, of cleaning the house, Marina's practice originally for her re-performers, and now that's part of the method. In the cleaning the house workshops, Marina actually, and the group that experiences that process, fasts as well for the 3 or 5 day length of the session, and during that time they would be slow walking, mutual gazing, counting rice, and a number of other rituals as well. So I think this is a chance to ask you once again in the audience what the role of ritual might be in your life and what impact, which rituals you actually preferred amongst the ones in there, which exercises you found most impactful.
Hi, hello everyone. My name's Simon. I enjoyed the sitting down and looking at someone part, only because when I sat down, the first time that someone sat down next to, in front of me, I knew her from years and years and years ago. And we hadn't spoken for like the last 6 or 7 years. And we had wonderful experiences with each other. Non-sexual, just the way anyone would, other than everything else around that. And I think it was even like just staring at her and you just kind of bounced eye from eye back and forth. You saw a completely different face from the left to the right. And I just thought it was amazing just sitting down, and then she sat down, I was like, get out. And we just smiled for ages and then just stopped and just stared and just talked really just back and forth without words. So it was really powerful, really enjoyed it.
That's wonderful. A wonderful story. Lindsay, did you want to say anything about the impact of each of those exercises? I'd like to, hope you don't mind, Lindsay. I'd like to introduce you to Marina's collaborator, Lindsay, who she first met in 2010 as part of The Artist Is Present, and who has guided all our facilitators and into preparing them for this experience.
Hi. I think that, well, there's a couple ways that I get to see these exercises. So I see them when we use them in like trainings or workshops to either prepare artists, like Sue was talking about, for long durational works, or now I'm using a format of that workshop to train all of the facilitators. And for them, we do 3 days of intensive long durational exercises so that when they get into this space and there's so much public and there's so much energy, they have a full tool belt of things that they can draw on when it becomes difficult or when they need to refocus. And I think all of the exercises help them to find that center, that concentration. And for the public, it's really beautiful because sometimes people are coming in and they'll do eye gazing for 10 minutes or they'll do slow walking for 2 hours. And what I love the most is seeing how people lose themselves and have that vulnerability and try something that they might not have tried in another moment, and all of that contributes to the communal experience in the space. That is what's happening in the space, the energy generated by a communal experience that people are having. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Lindsay. And she's really been an amazing presence here with us and an amazing person running this space down here. So, Heather, did you want to say anything more about the relationship then that you had with people that you met along the way? And
one of the wonderful things that you don't expect when you wait in a queue for a long time is that you're actually going to make friends, and if you're lucky. And lots of us got to know each other. So because we literally waited in queue downstairs, then we'd go upstairs and wait around the perimeter, and over the sort of 2 or 3 weeks that I was there, I sat on the perimeter a great deal of the time. I mean, I'd make very intentional days where I'm going to try and sit, but other days I just come to watch, and so we would see each other all the time. So those photos up there, I can name several of those people, but we also, someone got organised and put us on an emailing list, of course, and so from time to time I still get invitations to things in New York, and people update you on things that are happening in their life. And There was such an extraordinary diverse range of people. There were drama students, there were people doing PhDs, there were makeup artists, there were people from all over the world, from London, from South America, from Brooklyn, from Australia, from everywhere. It was just extraordinary. And the sense of community which is such an important thing in ritual, the sense of community. And I think that was very powerful and quite unexpected for all of us. And by the time the show, once I had come back to Australia, I'd always check in with the webcam, and so I had, you know, endless nights of just being up, watching the webcam and watching the crowd get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger around the show until that last moment, that extraordinary moment where Marina stood up. And I remember crying. I just cried. I went in yesterday to the show here and also found the sitting with people extremely powerful, because the only other person that I've done that with that is a complete stranger is Marina. And I sat with about six or seven people yesterday over a couple of hours, and it really is a remarkable, intense experience of human connection. And I think when I think about Marina and art, and a lot of people say, yes, but is it art? And they will ask that of this too, yes, but is it art? At its best and possibly at its worst, art is about human connection. And what we see here is a really extraordinary form of human connection in all those exercises, both self-awareness, as that lady said, that self-awareness that we get from those exercises, and also, oh, there she is. Yeah, that was so great. Can you imagine the pain of sitting down for 75 days? The only day she had off is Tuesday when MoMA was closed, and on Friday night she was there till 8 o'clock at night. And finally, to be able to stand up. It's amazing. And on the webcam, you could hear the crowd just cheering, just incredible noise of people cheering. So
reflecting on last days, here we are, and thank you so much for coming and sharing some of your responses and reflections on the project. Please join me now in thanking Heather Rose. Thank you so much, Heather.
Thank you, Sue. Thank you, everyone. Thanks.